Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? We are going to look at the constellation of Auriga. And in order to find that, we're going to start at Orion over in the south, which you'll be able to see about 3 or 4 hours after sunset. Orion, of course, has its three belt stars and the four distinctive stars around it. Most everyone can find this fairly easily. We're going to begin from this star, which is called Bellatrix. It's actually not one of the brighter ones of those four surrounding stars. Betelgeuse is here, Rigel is here. Those are the two bright ones. Bellatrix is a little bit dimmer, but not by much. It's a 1.6 magnitude star. And we're going to go up 40 degrees up towards overhead. Now, from where I am, Auriga is literally nearly overhead, several hours after sunset. If you are further to the north, it'll be more towards the south. If you live further south, you're going to want to look actually towards the north. But for those of us at 35 to 45 degrees north latitude, you're going to be looking pretty much directly overhead. That can make it hard to look for Dobsonian owners, so you may want to either start earlier in the evening or wait till later in the evening to find things, as it can be difficult to move those particular telescopes in that part of the sky. So, 40 degrees, how do we measure that? Pretty easily, you can actually take 15 degrees here and 25 degrees there. That's 40 degrees, or you can double up your fists. These are 20 degrees each. This is 15, this is about 25, so that's going to be about 40 degrees. You can even do this if you want to. That's about 45. We're going to stretch all the way from Bellatrix up to Capella. You can't miss Capella. It's a really bright star. I believe it's about the sixth brightest star in the entire night sky, so it's right up there. You're not going to miss that overhead. Now, the shape of Auriga is a little bit odd. It's sort of this pentagon shape. Some people even say a hexagon if they use one of the other stars. And it doesn't really look like what it's supposed to look like. It's intended to be a charioteer, and I don't really see a charioteer here in this shape. If you do, then more power to you. but that's where we're going. We're going to go past the horns of Taurus, basically, and up into this shape. So once we get up there, we're actually not going to use Capella itself, but as long as we know what the shape is, then we can find some really cool things in there, because we don't have the moon in the way this week, so this is a great time to start looking at some of your deep sky objects. So we have Capella here. This is Beta Aurigae, or Mencalinin. This is an important star for us to be to know is in terms of jumping off of for finding things in Auriga. This is Theta Aurigae. Down here, this is Alnath. That's actually Beta Tauri, so that's one of the horns of Taurus the Bull, but it forms kind of part of the shape that we consider Auriga to be. And then this star is Iota Aurigae. And you'll also notice that there's this little triangle over here. That's actually called the Kids. And when it's saying kids, it's actually not referring to children, it's referring to baby goats. This is supposed to represent some baby goats, so those three stars are the baby goats or the kids. But we're going to begin by looking at a line from from Theta to Iota, because we're going to start at Iota and kind of go in the direction of Theta to find our first object. Now, what we will do is look at this as if it is a field of view of binoculars. This is a correct image field of view. Remember, if you're using your finder scope, it may be reversed upside down and left to right. But we're going to start here at Iota Aurigae, and we're going to move in that direction. And the first thing that we'll notice before that star even leaves the field of view is we've got this line of stars over here on the opposite side. So there you'll see three, maybe four stars kind of in a row and a couple other dimmer ones there. But generally, you'll be able to see these fairly easily. This is a 4.5 magnitude star. So once you center that and Iota has left your field of view, you're going to see at the top this shape here, which sort of looks like a lot of people see this as a Cheshire cat. Now, that's not actually a star cluster. It's just really an asterism. And I can actually see how people would see that this sort of looks like a Cheshire cat, because you've got the two eyes here. You've got the big wide grin there, and it really does kind of look like the smiling Cheshire cat. It's a little too large to see in most telescopes unless you have a very, very short focal length and some very wide eyepieces. You're looking at about a degree and a half at least. You really want about 2.5 to 3 degrees to frame that well. So it's not really a great telescope object, but it is good for binoculars or even looking at through your finder scope. Now you'll notice when you look at the Cheshire Cat, you kind of have these three, seven stars or so. And these are between 5th and 7th magnitude, so the eyes are here, but if we go along where the teeth are of that smile, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and it looks like there should be an extra one right out there if we were to complete the smile as the asterism seems to be. It's almost like one part of the smile is just barely missing. Now, the good part about that is that's exactly where we want to go with our telescope, because if you click on that area right there, you'll notice there's actually a deep sky object there. So when we take this off and zoom in, all of a sudden there's, oh my goodness, a whole bunch of stars. What is this? That is Messier 38. That is also known as the starfish cluster. I don't really see a starfish in there, but that's what some people do see in there. That's okay. If you see a starfish, good. There's a ton of stars here. It's a really great object. If we take off our deep sky object, we can actually look at some of these stars individually and see that we've got even some of the dimmer ones are 10th and 11th magnitude. So even small telescopes of let's say 3, 4, 5 inches, and of course larger, are going to be able to resolve these from many areas, even with some light pollution. So you've got a really good object that has stars in it. They're going to be able to punch through, and you'll be able to see quite a bit of this. Of course, the larger your telescope is, the more you'll be able to see stars like this, which are 12th and 13th magnitude, and then it just becomes that much more impressive. So that's a really great object to look at. Now, nearby to this, if your telescope is larger and you've got some darker skies, there's another object to see. And what I'll do is actually bring that up with our deep sky objects. And you'll notice this right here, NGC 1907. That's another open cluster right nearby. And the way that you can find that is once you've located the starfish cluster, and of course, the Cheshire Cat smile, is if you look at this eye that's closer to Messier 38 and you drop straight down to the star that is closest to where the eye is, NGC 1907 is almost exactly in between those stars. So you can just recenter your telescope, zoom right in there, and this is a much smaller cluster. But even small telescopes should be able to resolve some of these stars because we've got 11th magnitude. Some of these brighter ones out here are 10th magnitude. Again, the larger your telescope, the more you'll see. You'll start to bring out some of these 13th magnitude stars and the 12th magnitude ones. It'll be that much more impressive. So the darker your skies, the better dark adapted your eyes are, and the larger your telescope, the more you'll see. But there are three great objects that you can see right in the constellation of Auriga, Cheshire Cat, find Messier 38, bigger telescopes, darker skies, look for NGC 1907 there, just along in between where the eye is. So that's all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.